As General Puta said in her introduction, I'm a professor of political science. And so the remarks that I'm going to give you today are going to come from that angle. I have been working and studying in Mozambique for a little bit more than 20 years. But I'm studying it as an academic and as an American citizen. So not as, obviously, as someone who knows it as intimately as our Mozambican colleagues in the room and some of you who have experience in the country as well. So in the spirit of modesty, let me offer you some remarks on the crisis of governance there. And I'll give you an overview of the violence and then sort of an overview of how what sort of attempts have been made to address the violence, what's behind it. But I want to start off by offering you a couple of ideas about how we might frame this crisis. So there are obviously different ways to look at this. One of the ways that we could see, so the question is, you know, why did violence resume in Mozambique after 2 decades of peace? Right? I mean, even though there had been some violent episodes in those 2 decades, really very little. If we look at the history of Mozambique, its war leading up to that period, if we compare it with other countries that have been through similar processes, really Mozambique had been quite peaceful. And recently there have been a lot of articles that I've read that said, oh, Mozambique is not a success story. People need to stop calling it that. Well, true, things have gotten much worse in recent years. However, I still think it's worth remarking on those 2 decades and thinking about why, not only why we had those 2 decades of relative peace, but why it's broken down now. Why now? So the first explanation is maybe that this resurgence in violence is the fruit of an incomplete peace process. And certainly there is some evidence, if we look at the kinds of demands RENAMO is making and we look at the violence that we see, there are some echoes of the original, of the earlier war that ended in 1992 and the peace process that was carried out then. So I'll talk a little bit more about that. The second possibility is that the political settlement after the war, which was based on formal multi-party democracy, really failed to consolidate. And I'll say a little bit more in my remarks about what I mean by that, but essentially what it boils down to is Mozambique's political process has been a process where you have an election, you have a formal process, and then afterwards you tend to have informal negotiations between RENAMO and the government about, well, what are really going to be the terms of our political inclusion as RENAMO? And again, I'll say a bit more about that. So first possibility, the peace process was not completely implemented. Second is that the political settlement, the political institutions didn't really consolidate. So we don't have a consolidated democracy. We don't have a settlement that everybody actually agreed on that had become institutionalized. And one of the things that supports this second idea is that you have a real asymmetry of resources on these two sides, government and RENAMO, in terms of the resources that are needed for political power or to just sort of act effectively in the political arena. So you all are familiar with asymmetrical warfare. This is sort of asymmetrical politics. And I can talk more about that as well. A third possibility, and again, these are not mutually exclusive possibilities. There's probably some truth to all of them. So a third possibility is that there are real and serious internal divisions within the ruling party, and that RENAMO's demands have activated those divisions. But not only RENAMO's demands, also this sort of shift in leadership style from a President Shizano, who was the first president after the war, to President Gabuza, and the subsequent economic troubles that the country has found itself in as a result of actions taken under President Gabuza's administration have made these internal divisions come to a head. And again, we see evidence of that in the way that President Nyusi was nominated to be the party's candidate back in 2009. Finally, economic growth and the discovery of natural resources in Mozambique. Right? Since about 2010, there's been really what could be described as a kind of natural resources boom. Many of these natural resources, I have a map somewhere. Anyway, I just, if you kind of picture in your mind the country of Mozambique, You'll see that in the central and northern provinces is where many, not all, of the natural resources that have been recently brought online, such as coal and natural gas, semi-precious gems, are located. And these central provinces are also areas where RENAMO has traditionally drawn a lot of its popular support. Okay, so all of these factors may have contributed to a resurgence in violence. And I want to say, kind of as my own overall frame for this, and it picks up on some of the themes that Dr. Fumunyo brought out, is that in post-conflict situations where you had a negotiated settlement, you basically have two conflicting logics going on, right? Because what is a peace process, a negotiated peace process? It's where the two sides come to the table, they are treated as partners in peace, they sort of have a parity, right? They're treated, you know, more or less as equals. What are we searching for? We're searching for positive sum solutions, common ground. It's about compromise, right? That's what a negotiated peace process is about. So you have a negotiated peace process, and then you move to the normal period of politics, right, after the war, which is characterized by what? Multi-party competitive elections. Keyword, competitive, right? So in elections, in electoral politics, you have winners and you have losers. Now, we can modify the electoral laws so that we can maybe soften that, but Mozambique doesn't have Mozambique's system is more of a majoritarian system, and even though in its legislature there's proportional representation, again, there are clear winners and clear losers. So this is kind of a jarring transition, especially where you have an opposition party that is much weaker than the ruling party in terms of those political resources that I talked about. Okay, so what happened in Mozambique? Essentially, we had a period in the first decade after the war, from 1994 to 2004, when President Shizano Frelimo was the president, and RENAMO sort of acted on this tendency that I mentioned before, its sort of inability to accept that RENAMO had moved from being Frelimo's partner in peace to being its competitor. When it lost in the first elections, RENAMO made all sorts of demands. First said these elections were full of fraud, we don't accept the results, we want a government of national unity, you know, and look to the international community, help us out here. We can't just be shut out just because we lost elections. There followed a series of talks, okay, you know, try to mollify RENAMO, reassure them, but it didn't really change the outcome. But RENAMO was given a forum, was given access to sort of discuss, you know, negotiations or discussions were put together where Glakama's people and people designated by President Shizano could talk about what did RENAMO want. So this pattern continued after each election. The expectation of RENAMO was we're gonna participate in these elections, but afterwards we're also gonna remind everybody that, hey, you know, we're your partner in peace. What about that? We know we didn't win, you know, everything we wanted to win at the ballot box, but let's talk about what else we can do. And on the other side of that, to be fair, elections did have some problems. RENAMO was not very well prepared to use the formal institutions to press its claims about things that it saw, problems that it saw in the elections. And so it, again, would sort of default back to these informal demands through the press or appealing to donors to sort of support their demands. In 2004, when Armando Guebuza became president, this pattern changed. President Guebuza was not as indulgent as of RENAMO's demands, right? He drew a very stark line and said, you know, you lost the elections, live with it. At the same time, Frelimo's electoral margins kept increasing until in 2009, they had 75% of the seats in the legislature and a similar, close to that share of presidential votes. Also in 2009, you had the emergence for the first time in Mozambique of a real third party threat, MDM, Movement for Democracy in Mozambique. Many RENAMO top leaders went over to MDM, not the very top leaders, but members of parliament, people who RENAMO had recruited to help it gain the political skills that it needed. Many of them left and joined MDM. MDM made a good showing in the first in the first national elections, which was alarming, I would say, to both Frelimo and RENAMO. Then in 2010, coal extraction comes online, and Mozambique becomes potentially a very large producer on a global scale of coal. And we had similarly many other natural resources being brought online. And so it's around this time, you know, back to the asymmetry of political abilities and power, we have, you know, RENAMO is not doing well in the formal institutions. They are losing elections by increasing margins. They have not increased their ability to act effectively in the legislature. They are seeing natural resource extraction happening in the provinces where they had gained, where they had had a lot of electoral support in the past, and they're wondering what to do. So RENAMO, again, calls for dialogue between itself and the government. This is sort of the last card that it has to play. And then finally, the government refuses, or says we'll negotiate, nothing really happens. And so in April of 2013, RENAMO officially says, the Rome Peace Accords are dead, they're null and void, we don't recognize them anymore, we're going back, we're taking up arms. And they announced that they would attack road and rail traffic between in the sort of southern central part of the country. And they did. And RENAMO's leader, Lukama, had already withdrawn from Maputo years before and had put his base in Nampula. Okay, so the violence that we saw during this period was had echoes of the earlier violence. So attacks on commercial traffic, attacks on passenger vehicles, on roads, kind of hit and run kind of things. The demands that we, and this violence, although it was sort of low intensity, had serious effects. Many people were killed, civilians were killed, rail and road traffic was severely disrupted, coal production was disrupted, it was coal shipments were suspended by Rio Tinto. So this violence was generating a real crisis for the country. What was RENAMO demanding? So RENAMO was saying, we're going to engage in this violence until you meet us halfway on our demands. What were the demands? One, a return to a more consensual and inclusive model of election administration was the first demand. Integration of RENAMO's various paramilitary forces into national police and security forces. This was a provision of the peace accord that was never completely implemented back in 1994. They also asked for a larger share of the expanding national pie. And here we see, you know, RENAMO negotiates its terms of inclusion into politics and economic life back in 1994 before any of these natural resources are actually online and real. Now, when we see the revenue being generated, you know, it might be tempting to say, well, let's renegotiate the terms of our inclusion at this time. They also called for separation of party and state. And most importantly, they called for a formal share in power at the provincial level. So during this time, there were always in the background ongoing negotiations, right? There were many, many rounds, more than 100 rounds of negotiations. Sometimes civil society leaders, like religious leaders, were involved. Sometimes it was just government and RENAMO negotiating teams. In 2014, the next national elections were scheduled. Mozambique has never missed a national election. They've had now 5 consecutive elections. Nothing has disrupted that. It seems clear that both sides were very interested in making sure that the fifth election happened. So the two sides did reach agreement on the electoral administration. So they changed the electoral law just months before the election to allow RENAMO to have representation on the National Election Commission and on the Technical Secretariat. Then there was an amnesty and a few other things that allowed RENAMO to participate in those national elections. It's very telling, I think, that when Lukama returned to Maputo to participate in those elections, he came in the company of Western ambassadors. This is, again, a sort of recalling of the 1992 to 94 peace process. So the elections were held in 2014, but there were charges of fraud. There were some genuine problems in some provinces. soon after the elections, by the way, in those elections, Renamo regained a significant share, both the party and Lekama regained a significant share of the support that had been diminishing over the last two elections. And so that could be taken as an indication that Renamo's decision to return to the bush did not hurt its popular support. Okay, in early 2015, so President Nyusi, the new president, elected in October 2014, soon after coming to power, reached out to Lekama and seemed to signal that there might be a return to, that he had a different style from President Kabuza, and that he was willing to talk about how we could bring Renamo fully back into the political process. Lekama reiterated his demand for provincial, for the two sticking points that remained were the demand for a share in provincial power, so provincial governorships, and integration of Renamo's forces into the police forces and the army. Renamo had been fully, you know, the integration of the armed forces had happened. What had been, in 1994, what had been left kind of hanging was whether or not Renamo would be integrated into police forces and which police forces it would be a part of. Okay, so while these discussions are going on, President Nyusi encourages Renamo to submit a bill to Parliament about provincial governorships. They do. There's a lot of discussion in the media and in civil society about the implications of having elected provincial governors, because for all of Mozambique's history, they had been appointed. Renamo presents its bill in Parliament. While it's kind of wending its way through, a constitutional lawyer named Gilles Sistak gives some interviews and says, you know, giving provincial governorships would not necessarily require a change in the constitution. Soon after making those remarks, Gilles Sistak is assassinated, essentially, in Maputo. Renamo's bill in the parliament is defeated by the Frelimo majority, and then after that, violence resumes. There's something new in this violence, though, after this period, and that is that we start to see the use of targeted assassinations. And this is something that we have not seen in Mozambique prior to this period. So we also saw the government sort of intensifying efforts to defeat Renamo militarily, even as negotiations were proceeding. For example, in October of 2015, Lekama was invited to sort of come, thought that he was coming to Beira for a meeting with President Nyusi, and the day before his house was surrounded and his security detail was disarmed. So there's a huge amount of mistrust, a kind of difficult parallel strategy of violence and negotiations. So in all of this violence, we see, as I said, some old patterns, also some new ones. And again, always in the background of this, ongoing kind of commitment in principle to negotiations, but with a kind of rotating cast of negotiators. Sometimes these negotiators would be, so there are several separate periods of negotiation efforts. The first was, or monitoring efforts, the first was in early 2015, there was an observation team that would observe the ceasefire and was to oversee the integration of Renamo fighters into national defense and security forces. This international team included members from Botswana, South Africa, Zimbabwe, Kenya, Cape Verde, and then Italy, Portugal, the UK, and the US. The US observers, I don't think were ever deployed, but and the UK, Italy, and Botswana recalled their observers before the conclusion of the extended period for compliance. So what happened was, this was right after the 2014 elections. There had been this agreement to allow Renamo to participate in those elections. They changed the electoral law. Renamo participated. There was an amnesty for crimes committed by Renamo since its return to the bush. And there was this provision for integration of Renamo fighters. Renamo never put names forward for people who should be integrated into the defense force. The observation team extended the deadline by 4 months, still nothing. So that team left the country without having been able to complete anything. But in June 2015, an agreement was reached between government Renamo on separating party and state, which had been another one of Renamo's demands, as you'll recall. provincial decentralization remains the big sticking point. In early 2016, Mario Raffaelli, an Italian politician who had had a big role to play in the original negotiation of peace in Mozambique, if you remember, the Italian government and Santo Egidio community in Catholic community in Italy hosted those talks and played an important role in mediation. Raffaele Marielli offered to help mediate talks about the remaining sticking points, which again include integration into security forces and provincial decentralization. So the government and Renamo both named their chosen international representative or interlocutors. And this will become important later on as we talk about, you know, what role for international partners. The government nominates Ket Masiri of Botswana, Jakaya Kikwete of Tanzania, and Tony Blair. Renamo asks for representatives from the Vatican, the EU, and South African President Jacob Zuma, and then each side nominated a local team to work with these external figures to draft texts on decentralization and security reform. But what was happening during this period was you had one foot on the gas and one foot on the brakes, right? So we have these negotiations going on with international and domestic mixed teams, drafting texts on how we'll deal with decentralization and security sector reform. But on the other hand, you have very strong efforts to simply defeat one another militarily. Okay, finally, just in the interest of time, there is currently in Mozambique a ceasefire in effect. Last fall, violence had reached a point where, you know, high-level representatives of RENAMO had been assassinated, more than a dozen of them. The last person was Jeremias Pondeka, who had been a member of this negotiating team, who had been a member of parliament as well. He was killed, and then both sides sort of stopped and looked over the brink and said, all right, you know, let's think about negotiations again. President Nyusi and President Lakama had a phone call in late December, agreed to a ceasefire, extended it multiple times, and then in August, Nyusi traveled to meet Lakama, where he's been in seclusion at the camp where he's been. Okay, so this might sound like just a sort of long litany of, you know, similar themes repeated over and over and over again with different problems kind of stimulating a similar kind of response. And I think there is some truth to that. Here's the question. What's new in Mozambique? What are we seeing that's new in this violence? And what are the implications for the future? And how does this maybe affect the region as a whole? One of the things that I haven't talked about and that frequently gets overlooked in these situations is what's happening with individual people? What's the role of ordinary people living their ordinary lives in conflict and peace in Mozambique? A recent event in Mozambique, a completely new type of violence has arisen that brings this question to the fore again, and that is these attacks in Mocimboa da Praia in Cabo Delgado, which are allegedly the work of Al-Shabaab, right? So these are local citizens who this violence has absolutely, apparently nothing to do with a long-term conflict between RENAMO and the government. And the question that it raises is, in all of these political negotiations, in all of the formal institutions that we've devised, have any of these been able to create institutions, including security institutions, that can protect individual citizens from these kinds of threats or prevent these kinds of threats from arising? And I'll leave it there. Thanks.